Hey everybody, thanks for watching our YouTube channel. We're constantly updating it with new content and never seen before content. So if you want to get the latest from Harvest, hit the subscribe button.
Give us our sin. We were. I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us.
You came from heaven to earth
to show the way.
Good evening and welcome in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. This is so exciting to see what God is doing, and we're so thrilled to be here tonight, and we're glad that you're here. Let's all stand for a word of prayer. Our Father, we're so thankful that you have chosen us and drawn us to be here this evening in order that we might have the privilege of seeing your work. And right now, Lord, we pray for each one that is here tonight who has not as yet made that commitment of their life to Jesus Christ. We ask you, Father, that nothing would distract them from hearing the word. For we know that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And so we ask your anointing on Greg as he shares the word with us tonight. And give us ears to hear what the Spirit has. You may be seated. And at this time, Benny Hester is going to come and share some music with us.
Nobody knows me like you. You put your arms around me, you'll bring me through. And there's many times I don't know what to do. Though some know me well, still nobody knows me like. In the beginning I never knew just how much I really needed you. More than a friend, someone I could talk to. You've changed me in so many ways. Nobody knows me like you. Put your arms around me, you bring me through. How many times I don't know what to do. Though some know me well, still nobody knows. Slipped and fell, and all of my faults, yes, you know them well. But you never took me away. No, no, no.
Nobody knows me like you. You put your arms around me and bring me through. Yes, many times I don't know what to do. Though some know me well, still nobody knows me like you, like you, Lord. Walking in your presence is where I wanna be. You said in your word, you said that you would lead me. Yes, I love you, oh, I really love you. I'll go anywhere as long as I know you'll be there.
You have me, we that I act sometimes. I am ashamed, but you never turn me away. No, no, no,
nobody knows me like you.
You put your arms around me, you bring me through.
There's many times I don't know what to do, though some know me well. Thank you.
Still nobody knows me like you. Well, you're going to recognize the people in this song right away. They lived a long time ago, and they watched someone that they loved very much be killed on a cross for things he'd never done. And it was their custom to prepare the body in a certain way, and they went there, and the body was gone. And they were shocked, and they reacted. Today, whenever we believe that Jesus Christ is not dead, when we know he's not in a tomb somewhere, he's alive at the right hand of the Father, just like he promised he would be. We react too, and we change, and something changes from the inside out. That's what this song's all about. Those that lived a long time ago and us today. He came out of an empty tomb to fill our empty hearts. Running, thinking it was the end. Her hopes lie still, shattered now, like many others had been. But the stone set to stay had been rolled away, and an angel met her and said, Mary, oh Mary. One guy in the fading light, he cried one night. His friends shook him and said, Thomas, oh Thomas, he.
Still. God's personality sometimes is so hard to understand. How he can be so great, and yet he can come down to us on our level with a great love, an unconditional love. You've probably heard this story told many times and read it many times, but this is my way of telling it. It's about a time in the Bible when God ran. Immovable rock, omnipotent, powerful, awesome Lord, victorious warrior, commanding King of Kings, mighty conqueror, and the only time, the only time I ever saw him run. When he ran to me, he took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, "My son's come home again." Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes, with forgiveness in his voice, he said, "Son, do you know I'd still love you?" It caught me by surprise when God ran. The day I left home, I knew I'd broken his heart, and I wondered then if things could ever be the same. But one night I remembered his love for me, and down the dusty road ahead I could see, it's the only time, the only time I ever saw him run. When he ran to me, took me in his arms, held my head to his chest, said, "My son's come home again." Lifted my face, wiped the tears from my eyes, with forgiveness in his. By surprise, it brought me to my knees when God ran. I saw him under me. Judge, he turned my way.
And tonight, that's exactly what he'll do. If you run to him, he'll run to you. God bless you. You have a great evening.
It must be tough to be a preacher's kid. All kinds of jokes are made about preacher's kids, and you're sort of expected to be the model. After all, your dad's the preacher. And I can imagine that it has its problems. But imagine the problem it would be if your daddy was as famous as Billy Graham. That would really be tough. Franklin is going to share with us Franklin Graham, son of Billy Graham.
Thank you, Pastor Chuck. You know, being in a Christian home, and when your father is someone like Billy Graham, many people expect that you're naturally going to be a Christian. I have met people, and I've talked to them, and I've asked them, when did you become a Christian? Oh, I was born a Christian. And I say, oh, really? I said, tell me about it. Well, my parents were Christians, and I went to church a couple of times a year, and so I was born a Christian. And sadly to say, many people, that's what they think it's all about. It's what you are at birth. But I want you to know that I was born a sinner. And just because my father was Billy Graham, that didn't give me any real, I don't think, special favor with Almighty God. You see, I had to choose Jesus Christ for myself. No matter how much my father loved me, no matter how much he cared for me, he could not make that decision for me. And that's the same for many of you that are here tonight. Nobody can make that decision for you. That's a decision that you're going to have to come to on your own. And for many years, I played the game. And what I mean by playing the game is I went to church. I knew all the evangelical language. I knew the right things to say, but in my heart, I was really living two lives. And when I got around the devil's crowd, I was one of them. And when I went to church, I tried to pretend like I was one of them. And when I was 8 years old, I remember a man asked me if I'd ever invited Christ into my heart, and I said no. And he said, would you like to? I said, well, yeah, why not? And so I invited Christ into my heart, but you know, I don't think it was real, because within a few years I had turned my back, and I was wanting to live my life on my own. I was wanting to do those things in life that would make me happy, and I just decided that if that embarrassed my mother and father, my actions, that was just too bad. They should have thought twice before they decided to have me. And that was really the attitude that I took. And I just decided I was going to have fun. And whatever in life turned me on, whatever pleased me, I was going to go after it. And that's exactly what I did. And I remember one year, I was in Switzerland working on a conference that my father was sponsoring. And it was my birthday. And he had taken me to a little restaurant. As we came out of the restaurant, he turned to me and he said, you know, Franklin, your mother and I, we love you very much. But we sense that there's a struggle for the soul of your life going on. And soon you're going to have to make a decision, and you're going to have to choose to accept Jesus Christ for who he is, or you're going to have to reject him. You cannot play the game, Franklin. You cannot try to walk the line and keep one foot on this side and one foot on that side, because it won't work. You're going to have to make a decision, and your mother and I sense that you're going to have to make this decision soon. And to be honest with you, it kind of ticked me off. And I tell you what ticked me off was because my father saw right through me. You know, I've got children of my own, and my mother, I've got four. My mother says I deserve each one of them. Two of them are here tonight with me, my two older sons. But you see, I thought I had been fooling my parents But they saw right through me. Many times as parents, we're able to see things that our children don't know that we see. And I was a little bit ticked because, you see, my father was able to see right through me. But what he told me burned like a knife. And I had really come to that point in life where I was just sick and tired of being sick and tired. Everything that I had tried, even though there was fun and pleasure for a while, there was an emptiness. And Franklin Graham was empty, and I was now 22 years of age, and I was at the point where I was just sick and tired of being sick and tired. And I believe many of you here tonight, you're at that same point in life. You're sick and tired of being sick and tired. And maybe many of you have come to church and your parents drag you to these meetings, but yet you yourself have never really made a commitment to Jesus Christ. And tonight, Pastor Greg's going to come in a few moments, and he's got a message from Almighty God tonight for you. And in a few moments, he's going to give an invitation. And that invitation is going to receive Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. And I want you to get ready and prepare yourselves to come. Because after my father had told me that, after he said, Franklin, you're going to have to make a decision, it wasn't until about 2 or 3 weeks later that I got down on my knees and I surrendered my life to Jesus Christ. I asked God to forgive me of my sins. I asked if he would forgive me and restore me and cleanse me. And I invited him into my heart by faith. My parents loved me, but they couldn't make that decision for me. And I tell you, I've never regretted it. It was the greatest decision I've ever made in my life. And I want you to know that my future is settled for eternity. I know that when I leave this world, that my sins are forgiven, I'm going to go straight into the presence of Almighty God, and that he loves me. And his son, Jesus Christ, died on a cross for me, and he died for you, and he took your place. You deserve death. I deserve death. But Jesus Christ died on a cross for my sins. And I've never regretted the day that I invited him to my heart. And tonight, you'll get that same opportunity, that same chance. God bless you, and I want you to know that I'm going to be praying for you.
And now we got a special dude to play a few tunes for you. Dennis Agajanian.
Church. Appreciate what Franklin had said. Some of you are looking for heroes, and the hero is to Jesus Christ, because he's the only way, the only truth, the only life. Who was willing to give his son? Noah kept on, his job was done. Moses and his children, safely through the wilderness. These men are gone, we're here to carry on. So tell me, why are we in such a mess? Where are the heroes now? When when we need them so desperately. Who will step out from the crowd and be strong enough to lead? Who will teach the children? Who will show them how? Oh, I'm asking you, we're the heroes now. There are those, we don't know the names, who've been faithful for our Lord. They were beaten, they were chained, put to death by the sword. The world is not worthy of them. Is it worthy of me and you? We'll safe endure to the end. I pray to God that it's true. We're the heroes now, when we need them so desperately. Who will step out from the crowd and be strong enough to lead? Who will teach the children? Who will show them how? Oh, I'm asking you, where are the heroes now? Surrounded by witnesses as they watch us run a race. Keep your eyes on the author of our faith. God is not ignorant, because if there's a man to lead, well, he's put you here to make a stand. He's calling on us today. He's calling us to be heroes now. Oh, when we need him so desperately. Step out from the crowd and be strong enough to lead. Who will teach the children? Who will show them how? Oh, I'm asking you, where are the heroes now? Well, where are the heroes now? When we need them so desperately. Who will step out from the crowd and be strong enough to lead? Children, who will show them how? Oh, I'm asking you, we're the heroes now. Young gal that didn't know the Lord said a television taping in San Diego. I witnessed to her because I was debating her on this TV program, and she was a prostitute. The great news is that Jesus Christ came in her life because she accepted him. And he forgave her of everything, and he could do that with you tonight. As Franklin Graham said, it doesn't matter what you've done. Raised in Texas, a beautiful ranch, your daddy left home. Her mama found another man, you're on your own. Won the love, she hitched a ride and went away to a city out of the country full of shame. She'd met a man, she lost her pride. Abused and confused, she started to cry. Oh, the pain I've never known, I was daddy's girl. Away from a family in a sinful world. I wanna go home to my father. She walked by a rescue mission and she heard a voice say, to give us all I had, I made a choice. My life is full of shame, Jesus took me all alone. The streets no more, my love was made of stone. I wanna go home to my father. God, I wanna go home, be daddy's girl, to be loved what I knew before. Take me what I am. I wanna go home. I wanna go home to my father. God, I wanna go home like a prodigal, to be loved what I knew before. Take me what I am. I wanna go home. I try. I had the opportunity of being at many crusades, and they had asked me to ask you very politely and kindly, when Pastor Greg gets up and speaks, please let's have no moving around. For young people and older people, if we could really sit and just listen and let the Lord Jesus Christ speak to your heart. He's here tonight and he loves you. This is my brother Danny playing beside me, my twin brother. Let's give him a great hand being here.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood of
can wash away my sins.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
What can make me whole again?
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Oh, precious is the flow.
All my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Sing it with me.
This is all my hope and peace, everybody.
Nothing nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Jesus.
Everybody now.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing but the blood of
gentlemen, let's welcome your good friend and mine, Pastor Greg Laurie. God bless you all.
Good evening. Well, let's all stand up for a moment. There's an old proverb that says the mind can place, isn't it? And he said, well, Greg, we have a big God. So a lot of people have been praying and they've been sharing their faith and they've been putting bumper stickers on their cars and the colors on the bumper stickers faded 12 minutes after they put them on the car. If you got one of these stickers, nothing has faded faster. But we're so glad that you could be here tonight and you can be seated. And when our time, we're ready to open up God's word and share some thoughts. Is on the Middle East and on the tiny nation of Israel. Today, Iraq, who invaded Kuwait and looked like it was going to be invading Saudi Arabia, and we have dispatched our troops, and there may be 200,000 plus troops from the United States of America before this thing ends. Iraq has now declared their hostility toward the nation Israel. And that should not surprise us, because the Bible tells us there is a coming a day when all the nations of the world are going to be gathered together against Israel. So I watch with great interest because, folks, before our very eyes, Bible prophecies are being fulfilled right now. The writing is still on the wall, even as we read about it in the book of Daniel. And if you come out here Thursday night, the title of the message is The Writing's on the Wall. And we're going to share with you what the Bible has to say about the last days and look at a lot of these things that are happening right now and have happened in the past few years, such as the crumbling of the Soviet power structure and the emergence of Europe as an economic superpower in 1992, a big year over there for the European common market. Things are happening. And as we see Bible prophecies being fulfilled, we remember the words of Jesus when he said, when you see these things begin to happen, look up, for your redemption is drawing near. There's no more time for excuses. It's time to get serious about God. And if you've been brought by a friend tonight, that's probably the best friend you'll ever meet if they got you out here. And if you've been brought by a friend tonight, and you're a visitor, and you're not sure right now what would happen to you when you die, if you'll go to heaven or hell, or if Christ were to come back tonight, if you would be ready to meet him, you can get right with God tonight. And we're going to give you an opportunity to do that in a few moments. But the reason that we don't follow Christ many times is because we offer excuses. Now, you know what an excuse is. It's something we make up when we don't want to do something as compared to a reason. I remember when I was in school and I had many great excuses that I made up as to why my homework was not done. And I remember my teacher telling me, Greg Laurie, do you know the difference between a reason and an excuse? I said, no, not really. A reason is legitimate. An excuse is something you make up because you don't really want to do it. For instance, you know, you may be at home, just really nothing to do, girls, and some geeky guy calls you up. You know, he's the guy with the thick glasses and 12 pockets or 12 pens in his pocket, and he calls you up and asks you if you would go out with him. And you say, no, I'm sorry, I really can't. I'm wallpapering my house. Yeah, that's the ticket, wallpapering my house. And so he hangs up, and then the phone rings again, and it's a really cute guy that you just met at school, and he says, I was wondering if you could take me to dinner. You drive and pay for it. You say, I'll be ready in 3 minutes, and boom, you're down there. That's because you want to do it. Well, here before us in the Bible is a story that Jesus told to illustrate the excuses that people make up as to why they do not want to follow him. Again, not reasons, but excuses. And it's amazing to me that more people do not seriously look into who Jesus Christ was and what he had to say. They've never read his words, but yet they reject something they've never even examined. I've talked to so many people, and I'll tell them, well, what do you think about Jesus Christ? Oh, I don't believe in that. Well, really, have you read the Bible? No, but, you know, I've heard about it. You reject something you've never read? You reject someone you know nothing about? If the Bible is true, and of course we believe it is, eternity is at stake, and that's why this is an alarming thing. For if Jesus is who he claimed to be, and his words are true, then there really is a purpose for life, a master plan that God has custom designed just for you. It means it's really possible to find peace with God and have your sin and guilt removed and have the emptiness and void in your life filled that maybe you've tried to fill with drugs, or you've tried to fill it with alcohol, or you've tried to fill it with partying, or you've tried to fill it by trying to find the perfect guy. I'm sorry, I'm already taken. I'm unavailable. Or the perfect girl. I was kidding, by the way. You're looking for some relationship to fill that void. Maybe you've even gone looking into religion to fill that void, but still it isn't filled because God has created that void inside of you to be filled with him. And if Jesus is who he claims to be, there is a heaven, there is a hell. It means we'll all stand before God and one day be held accountable primarily for what we did with him and the decision we made about him. And that is why, before this evening is over, we are going to give you an opportunity to make a decision, because you will make one. Now let me read to you the story from Scripture that our message is based on. It's Luke chapter 14. I know it's kind of dark out there, so you'll have to just take my word for it. And Luke 14, starting in verse 16, this is a story that Jesus told. He said, a certain man gave a great supper and invited many. And he sent his servant at supper time to say to those who were invited, come, for all things are now ready. But they all with one accord began to make excuses. The first said, well, I bought a piece of ground and I have to go and see it. Please have me excused. Another said, well, I bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm going to test them. I ask you, have me excused. Another said, I've married a wife, therefore I cannot come. So that servant came and reported these things to his master. And the master of the house became angry and said to the servant, go out quickly into the streets and the lanes of the city and bring out the poor and the maimed and the lame and the blind. And then he said in verse 23, go on into the highways and hedges and compel them to come that my house may be fulfilled or filled. Now Jesus is comparing an invitation to an earthly meal to God's great invitation for us to know him in a personal relationship. But as I already said, they made up excuses. And an excuse is really the skin of a reason stuffed with a lie. It's because we don't want to do something. The first excuse we know of is recorded in the first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis. And it's after Adam had sinned and eaten of the forbidden fruit that God told Adam and Eve to stay away from. And after Adam ate of that fruit, God said to him, Adam, have you eaten of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? And Adam said, it's the woman you gave me. It's not my fault. And then the second recorded excuse is recorded also there in Genesis when the woman said, the serpent tricked me. The devil made me do it. It's not my fault. They were unwilling to take responsibility for their actions. It seems to me we are living in a time when no one wants to take responsibility for what they do. It seems that there was a day a long time ago where people made commitments and they kept them. A marriage was for keeps. A job was for work. Adultery was a scandal. Hardship was endured. Crime was punished. But today, we blame everyone and everything for our problems. It's not my fault. I had a traumatic experience in my childhood. Or you might even say, I had a traumatic experience when I was in the womb, you know. I've heard that one. It's my neighborhood. It's this, it's that, it's the way I am biologically. U.S. News and World Report ran an article in June of 1990, and the title of the article is "The." And then there was a man who copped a plea after being accused of breaking into a corporate computer system and stealing an expensive security program. But did the judge see this man as guilty? No, he said, this man has an insidious space age element or ailment called computer addiction, and sentenced him to a year's treatment for this new and growing impulse disorder. The author of this article says Bonnie and Clyde came along too soon. Nowadays, they could settle for a year at the Betty Ford Center as victims of compulsive bank robbing addiction. And then the person who writes this article correctly concludes, the problem with all of this is you can't run a society or cope with its problems this way. If people are not held accountable for what they do, the way we are headed, the only generally acknowledged responsibility for our actions may be to explain them away on Nightline. But you see, it's so easy for us to blame someone else. And Adam and Eve blame someone else. In essence, they blame God. It's your fault. You put us in this place. You made this mess. It's not my fault. It's her fault. And she, of course, blamed it on the devil. So we always have an excuse that we can offer, but it's time to take responsibility for our actions. And then as we read this text before us, the invitation was given out to come. Now, it's important to understand the culture of this time to appreciate what was really taking place. There would be two invitations given as a part of the protocol at such a feast. The first announcement would be made, and you were asked to RSVP. In other words, you were asked to let them know if you could attend. We're having a great banquet, and we have chosen you to come. Would you like to come? And you would write back and say, yes. Therefore, considerable expense would be spent on your behalf so you could be an honored guest at this great feast. And then when the day came, when the second invitation was given, that was only to tell you what time to show up. Already the finest food was ready. The tables were decorated. The cooks had worked overtime. The musicians had rehearsed. And to refuse at the second invitation was the ultimate insult. In this culture, it was even grounds for declaring a war. And that is the situation before us here, where they were invited once and they accepted, and then they were invited for the exact time, and they said, I'm sorry, we just can't make it. It was inexcusable. All of these people rejected at the second invitation. Many people today will make a commitment to Christ, but if it involves any commitment or any change in their lifestyle or any inconveniencing of their plans, they renege. No time for church, but they have plenty of time for movies. No time for prayer, but lots of time for television. No time for the Bible, but lots of time for newspapers and magazines and anything else you want to read. It's all a matter of priorities. You make time for what is important. And drawing the parallel from this story, God has made the ultimate sacrifice for you. Great expense was spent for this feast, and they said no. Great expense has been spent on your behalf. God sent his own son to come to this earth and to go to that cross and die for you there. And he took all of the sin of the world upon himself, and then he rose again from the dead and offers you forgiveness. It would be as though you stood before a judge for crimes you had committed. And the judge, because of the law that you had violated, had to condemn you to death. And then it would be as though that same judge took off his robes, laid down his gavel, and stepped down from the bench and said, "Now I will go and pay the price for your crime. I will die in your place." And it would be as though you slapped his hand away and said, "No, get away." What can he do? Here he has made this incredible offer to you, and you've turned him away. God wants to forgive you of your sin, which is that barrier that separates us from him. A lot of people get real uptight when you tell them they're sinners. You say, "You know, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." "I'm not a sinner." "Oh, but you are." "No, I'm not." But you see, let's understand what the word sin means. The word sin does not just mean to break a commandment, though it includes that. Adultery or murder or theft, those are not the only sins mentioned in the Bible. The word sin means to miss the mark. And the mark that God has set for all of humanity is perfection. Jesus said, "Be perfect as my Father in heaven is perfect." Therefore, if you are not perfect and living a completely flawless life, you have missed the mark and have fallen short. "All right, well, I don't sin as much as that guy over there. Look at his lifestyle. He just left his wife. I'm only on my second wife. He's on his third." But one sin is enough to keep you out of heaven. "Oh, but I keep the Ten Commandments." No, you don't. You already broke one of them. "Thou shalt not bear false witness." You're a liar and you know it. Even if you've only broken one commandment, the Bible says if you offend in one point of the law, you're guilty of all of it. And because of our radical situation, because of this dilemma, God had to take drastic measures, and that's what he did when he made the supreme sacrifice and sending Jesus. So to reject this is crazy. What do you gain by rejecting Christ? You gain emptiness. You gain guilt. You gain separation from God. And you gain eternal judgment. But if you accept him, what do you really get? Oh, you get the forgiveness of sin. You have peace put in your life. You have the hope of heaven. And as you look at the world crumbling in front of you, you have hope in a hopeless world. And you know that Jesus will come again and receive you. And you know that whatever problem you face, he'll be there with you, walking with you each step of it. That's what he offers. To turn that away is crazy. The Bible says, how can we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? Now, I want to look at these excuses for a minute because they're really ridiculous. The first guy said, "I bought a piece of land and I have to go and see it." Now, does that make sense to you? Would you buy a piece of land without going and looking at it first? Have you ever bought anything from a catalog and when it arrived, it didn't look anything like it looked in the picture? I remember once I was reading a comic book. This was probably a week ago, I don't know, but and on the back of it, it said, 1,000 army men for $1. 1,000 army men. Yeah, I was about 9 years old. That sounds great. So I ordered them, sent my dollar, and I got 1,000 army men. And they were like the size of ants. And they had no dimension. They were flat. And the tanks that came with it, they were made out of little cardboard things that you cut out and stuck up. I thought, you know, it just doesn't look like the advertisement. But what I really love is the vivid imaginations that real estate salespeople have. Have you ever gone to the real estate section of your newspaper and looked at those great terms that they come up with to sell you a property? No picture, but it'll say something like retirement haven, great starter home, only steps from beach, the headline will exclaim. And then have you ever gone and looked at some of those homes? They don't quite measure up, do they? If it says retirement haven, that's probably a 30-year-old Sunbeam trailer with two rusty lawn chairs in front. Ocean view, the advertisement says. And you go there, and yeah, there's an ocean view. If you stand on the pitch of the roof looking through high-powered binoculars on a very clear day, ocean view. Or steps from beach. Of course, they don't tell you how many steps. 3 miles, to be exact, worth of steps. Here's the one to watch out for, though. Cute fixer-upper. This is basically a home with no windows or roof, but excellent ventilation. Or great starter home. That sounds nice. Great starter home. That's probably a pile of lumber with a set of plans next to it. Or when it just says sparkling pool and no mention of the house, I know we have trouble. For all they can sell is the pool. But that's the idea here. The man says, I bought a piece of land and I have to go and see it. Now, what was holding this man back? Possessions. He was saying land and possessions were more important to him than eternal things. A man's love for real estate is often an indication of his real state before God. What do you really love in this life? As I was getting ready to come here, I was watching Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous. Now, I don't watch this every night. It just happened to be on. But they showed the birthday party that Malcolm Forbes threw. And he spared no expense in flying people from around the world over to Morocco and spent lots and lots of money. He had everything money could buy. The people woke up in the morning and he had a fleet of Mercedes to shuttle them around to see the sights of the city. They had marching bands and soldiers and the finest food, everything. And they interviewed Malcolm Forbes and they said, well, are you going to do many birthday parties like this? And he said, well, I don't think they'll all be as grand as this one. That was an understatement because that was his last birthday. And though it was wonderful and spectacular and the television cameras were whirring away and so many people would sit at home and say, if only I were Malcolm Forbes, one day he died. And he left this life and went into eternity. I heard that Malcolm Forbes once said, I am not looking forward to the life I'm going into because I know I will not be as nearly as comfortable in that life as I was in this one. Well, that could be an understatement. I don't know if Mr. Forbes made a commitment to Jesus Christ before his death. I sure hope he did. But if it did not, what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Some people live for possessions. That's all they think about. You know, it's interesting. Back in the 60s, when they would interview college kids, they said, what is your goal in life? And the kids back then said, hey, to change the world. They ask kids in college today, what's your goal in life? It's to make money. I don't care what career choice I make, whatever can get me the most money in the fastest way, that's what I want to do. But for what? At what cost? At the cost of your soul? To drive the ultimate car? To have the perfect watch? To have the greatest home, to have the most money, and then it can all be gone so quickly and you're left with nothing. You know, I have never seen a hearse pulling a U-Haul trailer. Have you? You leave it all. You leave everything. Jesus spoke of a farmer whose crop brought forth generously. And that man said, oh man, I don't have enough room for all that I have. I'll pull down my barns and build bigger and better. And I'll say to my soul, take it easy. Hey, they were saying that 2,000 years ago. We still say it today. Hey man, take it easy. Right? This man said, take it easy. Eat, drink, and be merry. God said, you fool, this night your soul will be required of you. So is the man who lays up treasure for himself but is not rich toward God. Are you living for possessions? Or are possessions keeping you away from Christ right now? The Bible tells a story about a rich young ruler. And by the way, we will talk about him in a later message. But the Bible says that he was a ruler, which means that he had to at least be 30 years old. It says he was rich. It says he was young. That means he was sort of the first century equivalent of a yuppie. Probably had a BMW chariot. Came up with a bottle of Perrier. Hey, Lord, how you doing? What must I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus looked at him, and the Bible says he loved him. And then he says, I'll tell you what, buddy. Take all that you have, sell it, give the money to the poor, and come follow me. Now, that doesn't mean that every man or woman has to give up every possession to follow Christ. Because I would suggest that that man would have said, all right, Lord, no problem, I'll do it right away. Lord might have said, forget it, I just wanted to see if you'd do it. Or maybe he would have had him do it. But the reason Jesus asked that is because he looked right through to that man's heart and saw that that man's heart was ruled by possessions. On the throne of that man's life were things, objects, bigger and better. Isn't it amazing you can be happy with what you have till someone comes along with the newer version? You can put two kids in a room and have 100 toys. And if one kid picks up the one toy, the other one will immediately go over and they'll fight over that one toy. It's called coveting. And you know what? You don't have to teach kids to do that, do you? It just comes naturally. I never had to sit my boys down and say, "Now, boys, today I'm going to teach you how to be selfish. Say this word after me, mine." Hey, man, they're naturals at it. We're all naturals at it. Wanting these things. But what does it profit you if you gain this whole world and lose your own soul? So many people spend their money on the lottery hoping they're going to go to the big spin. They're going to win it all. Living their life in the pursuit of things that will pass away. Now, the second excuse is a man who said, "Well, I have 5 yoke of oxen. I have to go and test them." Now, either this guy's a complete idiot or a blatant liar. Buying animals without seeing them? Would you buy a car without test driving it? Would you be suspicious if the car dealer said, "Sorry, I can't drive that car. Just have to buy it as it is." And then you get in and you read the little sticker, "Engine optional. Transmission optional." Yeah, I want to drive it. I want to see if the thing works. But oxen would be used to plow a field. And so what this man, in essence, was saying is, my career is more important than God. I want to pursue my career, getting ahead no matter what the cost to my relationship with God or even family. I read in the newspaper today how many Orange County families are facing great stress because the husband and the wife is working and they have no time to be with the children. And the impact that has on the kids. And so many people, they don't have time for God because they're too busy with their career. But isn't it amazing that when the bottom drops out, we suddenly have time for God? When tragedy hits, we suddenly have time for God. I remember the extent of my relationship with God used to be, whenever I was in trouble, I would cry out, "God, help me." And you know what? He's so good and loving. He always came through. And I would make great commitments. "God, if you get me out of this one, I'll do anything. Just help me." He'd get me out and I'd say, "Thanks, God. See you next crisis." A lot of you are that way. But he's brought you here tonight to realize it's time to come up with your commitment. It's time to follow through. It's time to respond to him. But this man was letting career get in the way. And then the final excuse is my favorite, because he didn't say, "I have oxen, I have to test them," or "I have possessions." He said simply, "I got a wife." That's it. Life is over. I'm married. You know, Benjamin Franklin said, "Keep your eyes wide open before marriage and half open afterwards." Well, this man was saying, "I can't come because I'm a married man." Now, that doesn't make sense. Wouldn't his wife like to have had the night off? And, "Hey, we're going to go to a great feast, honey, and you can just enjoy it. You don't have to even do the dishes. Come on." Well, he said, "I married a wife. I cannot come." He was putting relationships before his relationship with God. Some of you have been held back to coming to Christ because of a relationship with a person. You say, "If I became a Christian, what would my husband say? What would my wife say? What would my parents say? What would my coworker say? What would my friend say?" The question is, what does God say? One day, we're going to stand before God. The Bible says that the small and great will stand before God, and the books will be open, and a book will be open. And if your name is not found written in the book of life, you'll be judged. You're not going to be up there with all your buddies kind of snickering, nudging each other, you know. It's going to be just you, all by yourself, looking at him. Is a relationship keeping you back right now? You might be with someone, sitting next to them, and you're thinking, boy, I'd love to say yes to Jesus Christ, but what will this person next to me think? And the person next to you is thinking, I'd love to make a commitment to Jesus Christ, but what will this person next to me think? Forget it. You'll find out who your true friends are. When I came to Christ, I found out who my friends were. I found out I didn't have a lot of friends. But then I found a friend, the Bible says, sticks closer than a brother, Jesus Christ. And I found, yeah. And I found Christian brothers and sisters, and that's something I never had in that world. I remember when I first went to Calvary Chapel, right up the street. I was a two-week-old Christian. I was a little hung up about expressing any kind of affection. I definitely did not like to hug people. And I go into this place that is filled with Christians, wall-to-wall Christian carpeting, you know. And there was so much love in that place, it kind of bothered me. And even though I was a new believer, I really didn't want to go in because there was so much of it. And I thought, these people can't be for real, loving each other, hugging each other. Hey, brother, I'll pray for you. God bless you. I thought, give me a break. It's all an act. They get together before church and say, okay, this non-believer's coming tonight. Let's put on a good act. Then afterwards, we can be normal again. Now, I'm not saying to you Christians are perfect. And I'm not saying I've never seen a Christian hurt another Christian. But what I am saying to you is I've seen an authenticity when a life has been changed by Christ, because I've seen it happen to me. Because I was about as cynical and as angry and as bitter and rebellious as a kid can be. I was raised down here on the coast in Newport Beach. Came from a broken home. And I was just sort of ticked off at the world. And I had this cynical, sarcastic nature. No one could tell me anything. And I was so hardened in my life. And when someone told me, hey, ask Jesus to come in, he'll give you peace and love, I thought, oh, give me a break. What is this, Disneyland? And then will I live happily ever after? And even when I prayed and asked Christ to come into my life, I had my arms folded and I said to myself, it won't work for me. But you know what? He did work for me. And that's why I'm here talking to you. If you give your life to Jesus Christ, you may lose a few, quote, friends, end quote. Some people make fun of you. Some people may give you a hard time. But listen, you're either going to have harmony with God and friction with people, or friction with God and harmony with people. But if your life is going to be right with God, it's going to bother some people, because the light will shine brightly and they'll be under the conviction of the Holy Spirit. But you just hold your course and don't let that keep you back. There's no valid reason to not come to Christ, only excuses. In every phase of life, we are asked the reoccurring question, what do you think of Christ? That's the question Jesus asked the religious leaders of his day. What do you think of Christ, he said, and whose son is he? When we're young, we're asked that question, but we say, well, I'm too preoccupied. Hey, man, I'm having fun. Plenty of time for that later. Then as we age into adulthood, we're too busy to think, hey, man, I've got to make a living. In older years, we say, well, I'm too old to think about it. My pattern in life is set. As death approaches, you're too ill to think. Your sensibilities have been dulled and your mind is tired. And then at death, it's too late to think. The day of opportunity is past. It's judgment time. And what guarantee do you have that you'll live to be older? We all think we're going to live forever, especially when we're young. Of course, here in California, we don't like to acknowledge aging. We have ways to erase it. Hair gets gray, diet. If you lose it, wear a wig. The skin wrinkles, get a facelift. Even they even do surgery now for hands. You can get a hand lift. Get all this cosmetic surgery, change yourself around. You're still getting old. You can try to cover up the effects of aging, but you're still aging. You can run around dressing like a teenager, pretending you're a teenager, but you're not one anymore. You'll find that out if you try to keep up with them. The body is fading. The body is aging. If you're a Christian, that's not something to dread, because it just means we're getting closer to the Lord, and hopefully we're becoming more like Him. But if you're a non-believer, it's all that you have. They have this thing now they call a midlife crisis. I don't even know if I believe there is such thing as a midlife crisis. I think it's a convenient way to explain away bizarre behavior. But there are certain telltale signs, they say. You start unbuttoning your shirt down, wearing a lot of gold chains, get a red sports car, try to relive your youth. But every day we're reminded that time is marching on and life is passing by, and some people don't even live to the older years. The Bible says in James 4, you don't know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? It's like a vapor of smoke that appears for a moment and vanishes away. That's why we're told in the book of Isaiah, seek the Lord while He may be found. You see, you say, I'll do it later. In a few moments, I'm going to give you an opportunity to decide for Jesus Christ. And some of you are going to say, I'll do it later. That's an excuse. How do you know there'll be a later? Every time you hear the gospel and you don't respond to it, your heart gets a little harder. The Bible says, he who is often reproved hardens his heart, and that without remedy. When you hear the gospel and you hear the truth of what it is to come into a relationship with Christ and have your sin forgiven, you enter into a spiritual danger zone. A decision must be made. And if you don't say yes, you automatically say no. And then you become inoculated against the gospel. Because the best inoculation against the gospel is the gospel, heard but not responded to. That means if you listen to this message tonight and you don't respond to Jesus Christ, if you have not yet done so and follow Him, that you are tampering with your soul and you're gambling with eternity. You say, well, I'll just do it later. If you keep hardening your heart, if later ever comes, you may come to a point of no return. You might say, are you suggesting that there would come a time in my life where God would not forgive me? No. I'm suggesting there may come a time in your life where you will not want to be forgiven, because your heart has gotten so hard by continually rejecting what you know is right. Or you might give the excuse, I'd like to become a Christian, but I can't give up my ways. Hey, it's important to realize that these things you won't give up could cost you eternity. Is it really worth it? Is it really that fun? Is it really that great? You know, let's be honest. Sure, sin can be fun. Anyone that gets up and says, sin is not fun, they're not telling the truth. We all know sin can be fun. But man, it has a big time penalty attached to it. The Bible says Moses chose to not enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. And that's what it is. Sin is fun for a while, but then payday comes. It seems to me that the world is a lot like an amusement park. You spend a lot of time waiting in line. A lot of time waiting for the big party. Waiting for the great fun. Waiting for the great payoff. You know, you get in a line in an amusement park, and it seemed like such a good idea that morning. Let's go to, and I won't say which park, but whatever. You fill it in. And after you get there, and you've been there 5 minutes, you say, why am I here? I'm $100 poor already, and I haven't even bought anything yet. I'm standing in a 3-mile line, and finally you get up and it's your turn to get on the ride, and you get in and they pull the little restraint down on you and off you go, boom, 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 get out. That's it, get out. Time to go to another line. Hey, stop and think about it. All the fun, all the pleasure, all the joy you had in the world, it was so short-lived, and there was so much waiting in between. And even as you were laughing and whooping it up, there was an emptiness. The Bible says even in laughter, the heart has sorrow. You can be laughing, oh, it's so great, happy hour, you know. there's a void and there's an aching emptiness in your life. You say, I can't come to Christ. I could not give up my ways. Sure you can, because if you become a Christian, Jesus Christ will take residence in your heart and he will give you a new nature. The Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he is an altogether different kind of person. Old things are passed away. All things have become new. He'll change you. He changed me. He can change you. You say, well, I'd like to come to Jesus Christ, but I need to clean my life up first. Hey, you'll never make it. Jesus doesn't say, clean your life up and come to me. He says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He says, come, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sin be as scarlet, I'll make it as white as snow. Come, and if you're thirsty, drink of the fountain of the water of life freely. He didn't say, get this together or change that. Hey, come as you are. Come with all your problems. Come with all your sins. It's like that old hymn says, just as I am, without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, O Lamb of God, I come. That's exactly how you must come, just as you are. The Bible tells a story about a young man known as the prodigal son. And by the way, tomorrow night, I'm going to talk about the prodigal son. And this young man went out and wasted his life, got involved in immorality and spent all his money and just took the family name and drug it through the gutter. And one day that boy came to his senses and decided to go back home. And upon returning to his father's house and walking down the road, Benny sang about it when he told us when God ran, took him in his arms and said, my son's come home again. God ran, symbolically, as the father ran. And the father didn't come up to that boy and said, boy, you stink. Go in there and take a shower. You smell like the pigs you've been hanging around with. And we'll talk about it later, maybe. Or get out of my sight. No. That father jumped up and sprinted so fast to that boy and threw his arms around him and smothered him with kisses. That's how God feels to any person who comes to him, no matter what they've done, no matter what sin they've committed. Even if they knew him at one time but have fallen away and would come back. Is God going to condemn you? No. He already took. We slapped his hand away and said, I don't want your forgiveness. We bring it upon ourselves. Well, I can't believe in a God of love that sends people to hell. Well, I can't either. Join the club. Because the God I serve doesn't send people to hell. We send ourselves there. The last thing God wants for any man or woman is for them to go to hell. You know, he didn't create hell for people. He didn't say heaven's for good people and hell is for people who, well, tick me off. That's how some people falsely envision God. The Bible says God created hell for the devil and his angels, for Satan and the demonic forces that follow him, not for humans. The desire of God is for you to join him in heaven. Jesus said in his prayer to the Father, Father, my desire is that they may behold my glory. Jesus said in John 14, let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you may be also. He wants you to join him in heaven. But you see, Satan is going to face judgment and hell, and so are his demons. And so if you reject the offer of forgiveness and say no to God over and over and over and over again, and one day you face judgment, you can't shake your finger in God's face and say, hold on here, this isn't fair. Hey, buddy, you had chance after chance after chance. God bent over backwards. And to get to that place of judgment, you had to reject him over and over again and practically climb over Jesus to get there. The Bible says God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. God wants to forgive you. He wants you to enter into a relationship with him. He wants you to be with him in heaven. He wants to come again and receive you unto himself. So I don't know what's holding you back, but whatever it is, it won't hold water when you stand before God. Yeah, well, there's so many hypocrites in the church. You're going to say that to God in that final day? Too many hypocrites, that's why. Did God ask you to follow people? I'm not excusing the behavior of certain so-called followers of Jesus who have not towed the line. But what I'm saying to you is people will let you down. People will fall short. People will disappoint. But Jesus said, follow me. Now, I've been following Jesus for 20 years. And you know what? He's never let me down. He's never been a hypocrite. He's never been inconsistent. He's never lied to me. He's done everything he said he would do. He's been all that he promised. And it's him I'm following right now. If people mess up, then I'll pray for them, because maybe one day I'll mess up and they'll have to pray for me. But just because there are certain people that haven't lived it as they ought to doesn't mean that you can use that as a reason as to why you did not follow Christ. He's calling you to follow him now. And there's no valid reason to keep you away. Only excuses. It's time to come. It's time to say yes to him. It's really what you want down in your heart. Jesus said, you're either for me or against me, with me or opposed to me. No middle ground. To be undecided is to be decided. To not say yes is to say no. Now, have you ever noticed that when you go to an elevator, it says up or down? It doesn't have a floor. Undecided. And you get up to that floor and all the indecisive people are pacing around. I don't know. Shall I go to the third floor, the first floor, the 13th floor? It's up or down. It's yes or no. It's in or out. It's for or against. And that's where you are now. It's time to decide. What's your excuse? Don't let possessions hold you back. Don't let career hold you back. Don't let relationships with others or fear of what others will think of you hold you back. Come to Jesus Christ now and find the forgiveness of sin that you really want. And leave the Pacific Amphitheater tonight a different person than the one you came in as. It can happen. Jesus says he's standing at the door and knocking, and if you'll hear his voice and open the door, he will come in. Jesus wants to come in the door or through the door of your heart right now. But he wants you to ask him. You see, as I was saying earlier, God doesn't send people to hell. He wants them to go to heaven. But Jesus doesn't say, look, I stand at the door and knock. If you don't open it, I'm going to kick it in, okay? No, he says, I want you to open it. I want you to want me. Isn't that amazing? The creator of the universe knocking on the door of my heart saying, could I come in? Can you come in? Are you serious? Yes. I'd like your permission. He wants to come in your life right now and forgive you. Fill that void in your life, and all you have to do is open the door. You say, how do I do that? What do I have to do to open the door? It's as simple as a prayer where you say, Lord, I know you died on the cross for my sin. I know you rose again from the dead, and now I ask you to come inside and be my personal Lord and Savior. And I'm going to give you an opportunity to do that right now. Let's all bow our heads for a word of prayer. This is very important. I'm going to ask that nobody get up and move around or leave early. It's imperative that you not move at this time. This is the most important moment of the evening as decisions are made. Father, we pray now that you will speak to those who do not yet know you, and help them to see their need for you, and help them to come to you and receive the forgiveness that you alone can offer, and get their lives right with you so they can meet you one day in heaven. This is their day of decision. Help them to see how important it is. Not put it off, but decide now. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Now is the time. In a moment, the praise band is going to play a song that is really a prayer. And the words are, Lord, have mercy on me, I need you. And I'm going to ask you tonight, if you want your sin forgiven, if you want to know that when you die, you'll go to heaven, if you want to open the door of your heart and ask Christ to come inside, if you want to be ready for his return, I'm going to ask that when this song begins, that you would get up out of your seat and come and stand up here. Now you say, well, Greg, there's not much room up there. I know that, so please listen. come up here, as many as you as can, if that made any sense. You know what I mean. As many as can make it, come up here. And then the rest of you, I'm going to ask you to step out into the aisle, and I'm going to lead you in a word of prayer if you want Christ tonight. If you want to get right with God. If you want to be ready for his return. If you want the emptiness in your life filled. When the song begins, I'm going to ask you to come out into the aisle, or that aisle, or that aisle, the aisle that's closest to you, wherever it is. You say, why do I have to do that? Because Jesus said, if you will confess me before men, I will confess you before my Father who is in heaven. But then he said, if you deny me before men, I'll deny you also before my Father in heaven. You see, following Jesus is an open and a public lifestyle, not something we do secretly. So it's time to stand up and be counted. So again, if you want your sin forgiven, if you want to open the door of your life and let Christ come inside, if you want to be certain that when you die you'll go to heaven, if you want to be ready for the coming of the Lord, if you want your guilt taken away, the emptiness in your life filled, I want you to get up out of your seat, come forward to this area, or come out into the aisle that's closest to you and make a public stand for Christ. And as you stand for him, he will stand up for you in heaven. I want you to get up and start coming right now. You that want Christ, get up and come. God bless you. Get up now. Nobody move around. Nobody move around. Get up now.
I need you. I need you. Oh Lord, have mercy now on me. Forgive me. Oh Lord, forgive me. And I will be clean. Lord, look upon my need.
I don't want anybody to get up and leave right now.
I need you.
Stay where you are. Those that want to receive Christ, get up and come. Come out to the aisle that's closest to you. Make a stand for Christ now.
Forgive me, oh Lord, forgive me. And I will be clean. Oh Lord, you are familiar with my ways. There is nothing hid from me.
Said this could be your last opportunity to come to Jesus Christ. We don't know how much time we have left. We don't know that Jesus could not come tonight or tomorrow night. You just don't know. Now is the time. If there's anybody else, as the praise band sings it again, get up. Now is the time. Come.
Oh, Lord, you are familiar with my way. There is nothing hid from you. Oh, Lord, you know the number of my days. I want to live my life for you.
Lord, have mercy now on me. Forgive me. Oh, Lord, forgive me. I will be clean.
There's still time. You're not too old to come to Christ tonight. You're not too set in your ways. God can change you. You're not too young to come to him tonight. You're not too immoral. He can forgive you. Jesus said, he that would come to me, I would in no way cast out. Get up and come. This last moment, we're waiting for you.
Look upon my need. I need you. I need you. Lord, have mercy now on me. Forgive me. Oh Lord, forgive me. And I will be clean. Oh, Lord, you are familiar with my ways. There is nothing hid from you. Oh, Lord, you know the number of my days. I want to live my life for you.
Lord, have mercy now on me.
Anybody else in this final moment, come.
Oh Lord, forgive me. And I will be clean.
Now, you that have come forward, you're in different little pockets all over this facility. We thank God for every one of you right now. Thank God for you. Hold on one moment. That's right. All right. Praise the Lord. Thank God. Now you that have come forward, you can be seated. I'd like to lead you in a word of prayer. And I'm going to ask you, wherever you are, wherever you're standing, that you pray this prayer out loud after me. Why? Because it's a prayer where you are personally asking Christ to come inside. You see, when you become a Christian, you're not becoming a religious person. You are entering into a relationship with God. And what's going to happen as you pray this prayer, Christ is going to come and take residence in your heart. And that's how he's going to change you. He's going to change you from the inside out. You see, it will be an inside job. So as I pray, I ask you to pray this prayer out loud after me. This is asking Jesus to come inside. So as I pray this out loud now with me. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, come into my life. I know that I'm a sinner, but I thank you for dying for me and rising again from the dead. Now be my personal Lord and Savior. I repent of my sin. Write my name in your book of life. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Help me to be your disciple and to follow you all the days of my life. Thank you that my sin is now forgiven and that I am now a child of God and that I am going to heaven. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Okay. Now, we have a serious a Christian traffic jam here with you people, and so it's very important that you listen to what I tell you. You that have come forward, we want to share a few words with you about what it is to follow Jesus Christ. We have a packet of materials we've put together on spiritual growth. We have a lot of counselors that are trained to talk to you. We have 1,800 counselors that would love to just encourage you. So this would take a few moments of your time. If you came with friends tonight, they'll wait for you. If you came in a bus, the buses will wait. And so this will be time well spent. And so behind you, now I know you probably can't see it, but up these aisles, there's going to be a guy with a flashlight. Let's hit those flashlight guys. See the flashlight behind you? I'm going to ask you to go back up this way, and we're going to take you to this upper area, up in the grassy area, and that is where we're going to give you these materials. So just sort of move up those aisles right now, and there'll be a person with a flashlight. Follow the person in front of you up those aisles. And listen, folks out there in the seats, don't anybody get up and leave right now because it will clog the aisles. Stay seated. Do not leave yet. Let's make room for these new believers to make the way to the top. Just go right up that way. Follow the flashlight. Praise band's going to sing another song.
Praise the Lord. Paul the Apostle said, how shall they believe on him who of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? Your friends that need to know Jesus Christ, how can they believe unless they hear? Tomorrow night they have a tremendous opportunity to hear the gospel. So bring an unsaved friend with you tomorrow evening, and we're going to see God work every night as we gather together in the name of Jesus. We rejoice in all of you that have come from near and far. I understand that there were 18 buses from Ontario tonight. So get together with your friends and let's be here tomorrow night and let's see again what God will do. At this time, and don't be in a hurry to leave. Why? It's better visiting in here than it is out there parked in your car. So hang around and just share the love of Christ. But Jeff Johnson is coming at this time, pastor of Calvary Chapel Downey, and he's going to lead us in prayer, the prayer of benediction.
Behold, the harvest is ripe. Thank God for opening our eyes to the times that we're living in. Thank God for what he is doing in these last and final days. How much time do we have? We don't know. But today is the day. And tomorrow will be another day to see this happen all over again. Let's pray now and let's close with this word of prayer tonight. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to have our eyes opened to the harvest field, that it is truly ripe, that we cannot save in 4 months then the harvest, but now is the time. Lord, help us to redeem the time, for the days are evil. We thank you for the burden for souls that you've given us tonight, for our hearts to be open, to beat with, as your heart beats, for those that are lost. Lord, thank you for bringing so many into the family tonight. Thank you for allowing them to receive your peace and your joy. Lord, bless each and every one as they walk out of this place as new creatures in Christ. Thank you for this opportunity to behold the hand of our Lord. Now go before us, Lord, and send us forth into the fields that we might come back again and see this happen all over again, night after night, all for your glory and your glory alone, in Jesus' name. And everyone said,
amen.
Amen. One more thing. One more thing. Before you go, take everything with you. That's trash included, okay? Let's leave a good witness to this place. All right, God bless you.
Friday night service will be at Corona Del Mar Main Beach, where all of these people who are receiving the Lord can be baptized. Friday night.